in your own home and say that aloud to the universe or your dog or cat or whoever is there with you. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Look at this beautiful backdrop that we have. Doesn't that look amazing? We are so delighted you are with us on this Easter morning. Our St. Matthew people, we are happy you are here. And if you are with us virtually, we're delighted that you are here. If you are interested in learning a little bit more about St. Matthew, there's information about who we are and what we believe in the tabs on Facebook. Please check us out. We our church, we love each other, we love being together, and we think it's very important to reach out to the world and love those who Jesus has put in our path. So we are delighted that you are here with us. We do have a YouTube channel, and if you would like to find it, all you have to do is, and we're getting it up here just a little bit, don't worry about it, but I'm going to keep on going. All you have to do is search on YouTube for SMUMC Lubbock, for St. Matthew United Methodist Church, SMUMC Lubbock. And there's some cool things there, some messages from our pastor, some beautiful music that Wendy has played. If you just like to have it in the background and have a worshipful background, we have some testimonies that are on there. We hope we'll be putting more on there eventually. So please join us on our YouTube channel. If you have a prayer request that you would like our prayer warriors or our entire church to lift up, you can contact our secretary, and our email address is there in the Facebook information, and we would love to lift up any needs that you have as a church. Our prayer warriors are also continuing to pray every Monday morning at 10:30 and early on Thursday mornings, and we hope, you know, as a community, but for sure as a church, we're going to continue at 9 a.m. on Thursday morning to pray the Covenant Hospital Prayer, because we feel like that's important that we continue to lift up our community. If you would like to do a Zoom meeting of any kind, if you will let the pastor or me know, we will help you set it up, or we will run that Zoom meeting for you if you're dismissing your Sunday school class, or feel like you need to have some kind of committee meeting or something, then we will be happy to make sure that that happens for you. We do have things that are going on. In fact, Ms. Carmen is putting some things together for our children, so we're going to be sending those out over email, we hope, this week. We will have our confirmation classes postponed for now. We feel like those young people really need to be together live, so we'll continue that as quickly as we can. And we're thinking about all kinds of ways to still keep in contact with our youth and our children. Our How Fortunate You Are campaign for the month of April is still continuing. And for today, you give a nickel for every first cousin that you have. And I don't know about you, but I have some pretty special first cousins, and so I would definitely like to give a nickel for them. And then tomorrow, we give a dime for every meal we've had in the last 3 days. Considering the situation right now, maybe you've had more than 3 meals a day. I don't know. We do have ministries that are continuing. Our first responder ministry is continuing. Our Aspen Village community, we are still praying for them and keeping in contact with them and trying to figure out ways that we can support them. If you have any ideas or if you can think of something special you'd like to do for one of those communities, please contact Todd or me or whoever is in charge, like Terry, with the First Responder Ministry, and we'll make sure that something happens as far as that's concerned. We thank you so much. If you sent in a check or if you donated on Applus this week, we are continuing to be a church, and we are continuing to keep the lights on and to support the ministries that we have and make sure that our wonderful staff still gets paid. If you have not and are interested in getting on Applus and have any trouble with that, let Todd know, let Jeannie know, let me know. But if you get on there and do it, you can donate any amount of money that you want to. There is a fee that goes with it. It's about 3.6%. You can incur that fee yourself, or you can let that be part of your overall donation. It'll be taken out, and the church will have to pay for that fee. But it's really quite easy to do. It takes less than a minute to get on there and do something with Applus. Again, we're so glad you joined us. for this communal recognition that our Christ has risen. That it's Easter Sunday. We just pray that this is a blessed time for you and all of us that are here. Just please join me in the opening prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just give you our time this morning. We just pray that you rain down your blessings on this service and anybody who is connected now or connects through the week on Facebook. And we just thank you for sending your Son and for conquering death and for ripping that curtain between the Holy of Holies and the priests and all of us. Thank you for loving us enough that you were willing to send what was most precious to you so that we could have communion with you. And we thank you and praise you and just give you this service this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. And Carol is going to lead us in our hymn of praise this morning.
Our hymn of praise is number 302, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Rejoice and triumph, Lord, O Lord, holy.
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn of inspiration this morning is number 310, He Lives. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning just grateful to be here and so thankful for what you've done for us. And we ask that you pour your blessings on our community. We lift up those in our community who are having to deal with COVID-19, all of our medical people, those that are connected here with St. Matthew. We lift those people up to you and just ask that you protect them. We lift up those that all of us, you know, personally, perhaps know, who have developed the virus, and we just pray that you will comfort them in this time, remove anxiety and fear, and carry them through this illness. And we just lift up the caretakers, and we lift up our leaders, Lord, our
local, our state, and our national leaders, just pray that you will give them wisdom. We pray especially this morning for our seniors in high school and college who everything has changed for them. Just pray that you will still allow them to get what they need out of their classes and yet to find a way to celebrate this really important time. And we lift up our church and our church members, and we lift up all those fellow Christians around this city and the nation that are worshiping and celebrating you this morning. And we just pray blessings over their services. And we give you our song, we give you our pastor this morning, and we just pray that you'll bless him, and just please help us to all hear within our hearts exactly what we need to hear out of the sermon this morning. And now, if you will just all join me as we pray the way our Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Pam. Thank you, everybody, for being here this morning. Guys, welcome. If you're tuning in for the first time, or for, I think this is our fourth, Sunday to do this online. Yeah, so, man, we went from not very much technology to here we are right in front of you. So that's awesome. A lot of y'all are probably learning new things about social media out there too. I know. I've had several questions, you know, and they're not like, how do we get on Facebook? Now they're like even more complicated questions, some of which I don't know about how making a post, you know, how do you like something? So I'll leave that to the experts, but I just want to tell you, I'm so glad that you're with us today. And guys, thank you for giving. You know, as we come to pray over our offering this morning, I know that it is hard to do some things outside of ourselves when we are under such distress, and when we are under such anxiety, and when we are things around us just aren't going well. My first inclination, if you're like me, is just to close up and to huddle in. But I tell you what, you know, with our church family, that's not what I see happening. And so thank you all for the text messages of encouragement and the phone calls and the emails that you're sending to me and to all of us here. The way that you are reaching out as a body in Christ to each other is just absolutely incredibly wonderful. What a great gift that you are to us. And what a great gift that you are to God. And what a great gift that God is to all of us. And it's in that gift, it's in his giving. And on this day, as we really remember, and as we are really, really thankful, that inspires us and that teaches us and that leads us to give back to him. I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about kindness. I'm talking about love. I'm talking about encouragement. I'm talking about prayer. I'm talking about sharing hope. Remember when it happened for you. Remember when that day was that you accepted Christ into your life. What a glorious and wonderful day, all because of what we remember today. None of it would be possible without the resurrection. And so as we come to pray thanksgiving and blessings over the gifts that he has given us, we also come to pray that he would bless what we give back to this community, to each other, to our family, to this nation, to this world, in sharing Christ. So will you pray with me? Father God, we thank you so much, Lord, for all that you have done for us. Lord, on this day, as we remember Easter, as we remember you, as we looked this last week, we walked step by step with you through each day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, starting with Palm Sunday and the parade, Lord, has ended, and I'll come to this glorious moment of an empty tomb of you being risen. It was all true, God. It was all true, Lord, and it is still true today. And it's in that truth, God, that we come to give back to you, Father, that we come with our gifts, with our money, with our time, with our talents, Lord, Father, that we put back into this world that you exactly did Easter for, Father. Us, people outside of these walls, people not on Facebook, people that we don't even know, you did all of that for all of us, God. And it's so with that that we are so thankful and that we can be so gracious and that we can love so much, God, because of what you did for us, Father. So bless this money. Bless our time. Bless our conversations. Bless our encouragement, Lord. Bless our prayer time as you bring people to mind that we need to call, that we need to send an email to, that we need to reach out to, Father. Lord, we ask that you bless all of that, Lord. Don't let us hold back, God. Don't let us retreat, Father. Don't let us go backwards, Lord. Don't let us just sit. If you have someone you want us to call, Father, I pray right now, Lord, that we would do that, Lord. If you have somebody that we know that needs encouragement, that needs your love, that needs your hope, Father, we ask as a gift, God, that you would bless us to do that, Lord. Thank you, Father. We love you. And all of God's people said, amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is Matthew 28, 1 through 10. Matthew 28, 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know what you are looking for. You're looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'"
Thank you, Pam. We have a battery issue right now with our wireless, and so we're getting that fixed. And so I thought I put a new battery in it, but it's kind of like the battery's laying around the house, you know. I'm not really quite sure it was completely new, maybe, looking at it right now. I love that scripture reading in Matthew chapter 28. It just makes me think, could it really be? What if hope still has a chance? Could it be that the end is just the beginning? Could it be that the cycle is broken? Could it be that the sinner can be forgiven? Has light conquered darkness? Has love conquered fear? Has life conquered death? Could it be that he is alive? Could it be that he is risen? I read a book in college called If It Had Happened Otherwise, and it's a really good read. It's a collection of essays published in 1931, which contain fictional accounts written by leading historians, and it's examining what they call alternate history, also known as counterfactual history. And so it's kind of like the movie Back to the Future, if you can think of it that way, kind of on steroids. You know, where they go back and they change one thing in the past, and it changes everything in the future. Except this is an actual field of study that you can get a degree in. where historians attempt to answer the what-if questions, if certain key historical events had not happened. Now, some of the essays include in this, if it had happened otherwise, collection, if Lee had not won the Battle of Gettysburg. And guess who that was written by? That was written by Winston Churchill. Another one was, if Napoleon had escaped to America, that was written by H.A. Fisher. I like this one, if Booth had missed Lincoln, that was written by Milton Waldman. And I just think it's really an interesting read. But what I'd like to do this morning, just for a second, and I'd just like to take a moment, and I'd like to ask this question, what if the resurrection had not happened? So, you know, we see a lot of things today that we take for granted. Obviously, Easter, hope, forgiveness, satisfaction, reunion, hospitals. You know, a lot of hospitals were started early on by the Christian community. A lot of orphanages were started on by the Christian community. We would have to get rid of healing, and we would have to get rid of grace. Heaven's a pretty big one, right? You know, hope would go away. Really, a true meaning, redemption, a reunion with those that have gone on before us. All of those things would be taken off the board if the resurrection had not happened. In a deeper sense, what that would mean for us as Christians is that, and then follow me here, if there is no principle of resurrection, then that means Jesus did not rise from the dead. And if Jesus did not rise from the dead, then death has power over him, and death defeated him. And if death has power over Jesus, then he's not really God, right? And if Jesus is not God, then he cannot offer this complete sacrifice for sins. And if Jesus couldn't offer a complete sacrifice for sins, then our sins are not completely paid and forgiven before God. And then if my sins are not completely paid or forgiven before God, then I am still in my sin. And so therefore, if Jesus is not risen, what that means is that he is unable to save. And worse still is that if Christ is not risen, then even those who have gone before us, those that have died, they're gone forever. And even worse than that is that if Christ is not risen, if there's no principle of resurrection, if it's not true, then really the whole Christian life then would just be a joke. I mean, if we don't have something beyond us to look forward to, then why even hassle with the life of Christians and all anyway? Thank you very much, fam. I appreciate it. We're going to do a switch out here real quick. Thanks. Thanks, Wendy. So that's a lot of what ifs, right? I mean, and you may think that this is a silly exercise of what I just did in what ifs, but really what I just outlined for you is in the Bible. It is what Paul talked to Christians about in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. See, the church at Corinth was one ridden with lots of issues, guys. But they were also a congregation for which Paul truly loved, and he had almost this paternal relationship and feelings for them. Now, their problematic condition stemmed from two important but not totally exclusive factors. The first factor was that they were a young Christian community starting out. And the second was that they belonged to a very, how do I put it, very colorful society, brimming with various views, to say the least. Being a seaport city, Corinth was fertile ground for various kinds of influences, and not all of those influences were good. Then Paul sees these influences taking hold in the church there, so he is reminding the Corinthian church about the belief in the resurrection as the foundation of our Christian faith, because he saw those forgetting its importance, well, they were losing theirs. They were losing their faith. So for us today, I've got just a few questions. One being, have we ourselves lost sight of the power of the resurrection? Have we forgotten the power of the resurrection? Are we really living out of the power of the resurrection? Now, I don't know if you're like me, but what if is a question that I am really good at asking. Constantly coming up with things to worry over that probably will never happen. Living long hours of agony over the regret of, had we only said this, or had I not said that, or had I been here or not been there? It can consume us. It can eat us up. It can keep us out of the thread of life. It can keep us out of God's abundant life, asking what ifs. But you know what? Along those lines, an even bigger question for us today, especially during COVID-19, is what's next? I hear a lot of people asking that today. And we really want to know, what's next? You know, it's true that during a catastrophic event or a disaster, the question, what's next, is second only to the question, am I okay? It's a big question for us, what's next? And right now, we are really asking a lot, what's next, more than ever. Well, 2,000 years ago, there was a catastrophic event outside the city walls of Jerusalem. Jesus Christ was executed, and the disciples hid behind locked doors, fearfully asking, what's next? The man they had followed for over 3 years, the man they believed would save Israel and their world, had died this horrible death. They scattered and they hid, grief-stricken and frightened, wondering if they too would be targeted, wondering, what's next? Now, they weren't the only ones asking that question of what's next. Jesus' enemies were also asking what's next. In fact, they asked for a special guard to be placed outside of Jesus' tomb because they did not want anyone to steal the body because they didn't know what would happen next. That's found in Matthew chapter 27. Well, 2,000 years later today, we can answer some of the what next questions that they asked. In fact, thousands of people who claimed to know Jesus Christ flooded Jerusalem right after the crucifixion. That's what was next. Saul of Tarsus was converted, by the way, and given a new name, Paul, and he spread the gospel to the north and to the east. That's what was next. By the end of the first century, Christianity had spread through the entire Roman Empire. That's what was next. By the fourth century, Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire. That's what was next. 2,000 years after Christ's death today, 2 billion people profess to be followers of Jesus Christ. That's a massive number. And guess what? That's what was next. All because of what happened after they laid Christ in the tomb. The resurrection. That's what happened next. Now, Jesus, you're never going to find him wondering what's next, right? During the Last Supper even, Jesus sat with his disciples knowing exactly what was going to happen next. Jesus would be arrested, and he knew next that he would go through a mock trial, 6 of them in fact, and he knew next that he would be sentenced to death, and he knew next that he would die, and he knew next. See, Jesus always knew what was next. He knew Judas would betray him, but he shared his last meal with him. He knew that Peter would deny him, but he shared his last meal with him. He knew the disciples would run away and they would be confused, but he shared his last meal with them. He knew what would happen next, and he did it anyway. And he was crucified. But then, 3 days after his crucifixion, let me tell you what was next. Jesus rose from the grave. He was alive. That's what happened next. So let me ask you this morning, what's next for you? In Romans 8:1, it says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Did you know that the word power occurs 57 times in the New Testament? It's used to describe this most powerful event that ever happened, an event that separated AD from BC, the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And that resurrection power, guess what? It is available now to change your life and my life. That's what's next. The most important thing in life is knowing Christ and experiencing the power of his resurrection. Now, Paul writes in Philippians chapter 3, he says this. He says, I want you to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. In another letter, he tells all of his readers from Ephesians chapter 1, I pray that you will begin to understand, now listen to this, how incredibly great his power is to help those who believe him. It is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor of God's right hand. Now, Paul uses the Greek word for power, dunamis, which is the root for our word today, dynamite. So Paul is saying God really, literally wants to give you dynamite power that can change your life. Yes, it's the same power that raised Jesus from the dead 2,000 years ago, and it's available to us right here, right now, to transform us. Resurrection power is the power to cancel our past. Resurrection power is the power to cancel our failures. Resurrection power is the power that cancels our mistakes and our sins and our regrets. And when I say cancel, I'm not talking about pretending it's not there, right? When I say cancel, I mean blot out. I mean remove. I mean truly, completely cancel. Have you ever gotten halfway through a project and wished you could start over? Lots of people are saying, or half the people in the living rooms are saying amen probably right now, right? I mean, a lot of people really feel that way, though, about life. I've made so many mistakes. I wish I could just wipe them out and I could start over. Failures, problems, bad decisions. Look, guys, we have all suffered from them. But some people just can't seem to let go of that past. And as a result, they let their past limit right where they are in their present. They live in a constant state of regret, continually agonizing over, if only I hadn't done that, or if only I had made these changes earlier. They repeatedly second-guess themselves, and they're tormented by these painful memories. I blew it, and I'm going to be paying for that for the rest of my life. That doesn't have to be what's next. Amen? God says that it is unnecessary for us to go around with a heavy load of guilt and old hurts and memories of mistakes. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 13, he says, he has forgiven all of our sins and canceled every record of the debt that we had to pay. And he did it by allowing Christ to be nailed to that cross and by Christ's resurrection. That's what's next. Jesus Christ knows the things that we have done wrong, but guess what? He didn't come to rub it in. He came to rub it out. That's what's next. He didn't come to condemn us. He came to save us, to change us. That's what's next. A clean slate is so completely possible, guys. Think of it in terms of an etch-a-sketch. Do some of y'all remember that? Now, for younger generations, that's not an app on your phone. It was actually a little device with knobs on it, right? If you can make a mess of a design or a picture on that etch-a-sketch, remember, all you have to do is you just have to flip it over, and it wipes the slate clean again. Then you get to start all over doing your little picture, your design. And the Bible says this is what God does with the mistakes that we have made. When we come to Him, He wipes, He totally wipes the slate clean. In Jeremiah chapter 31, God says this to the Israelites. He says, He will remember their sins no more. Now, look, guys, this to me is one of the most amazing statements in the Bible if you know the history of the Israelites, that the God who made the world forgets. When we come to Him and when we admit our sins and ask Him to forgive us, He cancels our past. God chooses to forget our wrongs. He chooses to forget our mistakes. He chooses to forget our failures. And that's good news. That's great news. That's the best news. Even if we were to die tonight and stand before God in heaven and we'd accepted Him and we would ask Him about some sin we committed maybe yesterday, guess what He would say? What sin are you talking about? He has totally and completely canceled our past and set us free to get on with the present. That's what's next. When Jesus died, one of His last statements from the cross was this: "It is finished." Now, this phrase consists of just one good Greek word, that's telestasia, literally meaning paid in full or canceled. It was the word that merchants wrote on bills back in that time when they were paid in full. And it was the word that was stamped on the document in the court system that declared a prison sentence to be commuted. And Jesus says that is exactly what He did on the cross and through His resurrection. He paid the price in full for every sin that we had ever committed. Remember Romans 8:1, we looked at it earlier? It says, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Jesus was crucified on the cross so that we could stop crucifying ourselves. He was hung up there for our hang-ups here. That's great news. The question is, if God forgets a sin the moment that we confess it, don't you think we ought to forget it? Two, how long do you remember a bill after you paid it? I try to forget about mine immediately. I'm not thinking about last month's bills at all, right? Likewise, since Christ has paid our bill in full, we don't need to think about it anymore. Someone said, I don't know, the revival I was at, you know, when I was in my teens, that when we give God all of our mistakes and our failures, that He throws them into the deepest part of the sea. And then He puts up a sign that says, "No fishing," right? He doesn't want us to keep dredging up our sins. Paul also said in Philippians chapter 3, and I love this verse, forgetting what is behind, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. However, we often, as people, can short-circuit God's power in our lives by not believing that God has truly forgiven us, or even by choosing not to forgive ourselves. God's resurrection power is the power to cancel our past. Regardless of what you have done, your future has been redeemed because of Christ's sacrifice and resurrection. So as the praise band comes up and they begin to play, I just want to ask you, in all the what ifs right now that you're facing, here in our sanctuary, guys, in all the what ifs right now that we're facing, let me ask you this question. What's next for you? See, the resurrection didn't happen. The resurrection did happen. And there's this all-encompassing God power in it. And because of his resurrection and that it happened, then all the things that we took off the board, right, at the beginning of the sermon, all that goes back on. And I summarize that in these three simple words that can never, ever be erased. Purpose, grace, and hope. Purpose for you, grace for you, and hope for you. Luke 23 tells a great story about two thieves that were hanging on either side of Jesus on the cross. In verse 39, he starts off by saying, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at Jesus. And he told him, he said, aren't you the Messiah? Then save yourself and us. But the other criminal, this guy rebuked him. And he asked him a question. He said, don't you fear God? Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man, talking about Jesus, this man has done nothing wrong. And then that criminal says to Jesus these words, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And then Jesus gives him this answer. I love this. Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. What was the difference between the two thieves? One of them believed. One of them believed. And what was next for the thief that believed? Purpose, grace, and hope. All because of Christ's resurrection. All because he believed. And guess what? That can be next for you too. Regardless of what you have done in your past, your future has been redeemed because of Christ's sacrifice and resurrection. And if you believe in him, that's what's next for you. In fact, what's next can be right now if you want him in your life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the power of the resurrection, God. Lord, forgive me the days that I forget that power as I go through life, Lord. But right now, Father, everything has changed. Lord, we are craving groups. We are craving community, Father. But we have you. And Lord, it is in that having you, Father, that it's all true. Everything that you said, everything that you did leading up to that cross, it's true because Jesus was raised again from that grave, Father. Lord, in our sunrise service this morning, we talked about how you rolled the stone away and he walked out of that grave, Lord. And I just know this morning, Lord, I am a byproduct of you still rolling the stone away. Father, it doesn't matter the sin, it doesn't matter the past, it doesn't matter what we have done or who we've done it to or how we have treated people. Father, you roll that stone away. Father, it doesn't matter the graves that we are trapped in with insecurity, or the graves that we are trapped in addiction, or the graves that we are trapped in anger or hurt or resentment, Father. Today is a testament to us that you roll that stone away, Father. God, bring new life inside of us, Father. Lord, we love you, and we thank you so much for what your Son did on that cross and the resurrection, telling us that it's all true, that our sins are forgiven. God, we love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Declared the grave has no claim on me.
Thank you so much for joining us this Easter morning. Whether you are with us right now or with us sometime during the week, we are very honored that you chose to spend this time with us. We want to remind you that we're available for prayer requests at any time. Our information is up there on Facebook. We are a praying church. We will lift up your requests. We are honored if you let us do that for you. If you are part of the Lubbock community or part of our family here at St. Matthew, we also want to remind you that we have a care team. And if you cannot get out and get groceries or a prescription, we certainly do not want you to do without. You contact one of those care team members, you contact our secretary, and we will make sure that your needs are met. We'll go and get whatever you need and set it on your porch, and then you can come get it, because we love those that are part of St. Matthew and those that are with us this morning, and we want to make sure you're taken care of. As we depart together this morning, as we depart until we meet again, just want to remind you of our church's scripture that we have chosen to represent us, and that is Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. And we have hope because he is risen. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter.